evening, everyone. Thank you for being back with us tonight. Typically, on the first Sunday night of the month, we have a series of sermons that we do once a month, a 12-part series. And I have a series planned, but we're not going to start it this month. We may start it next month. We may postpone it. We'll just see what the future holds. But certainly, we're not going to do it today because I wanted to finish, or rather elaborate more on, the theme that we started this morning. If you recall, if you're here this morning, we started by looking at a spiritual physical and looking at some things that the doctor might say to us when going for a checkup. Well, what would God say to us if we went in for a spiritual checkup? I don't normally like to do two-part sermons, at least not when there's so many hours in between the two. If we have an afternoon meal or something, then that's fine. But I didn't want to cut. I had so much more material. I ended up having to cut a lot more, but I didn't want to preach for 40, 45 minutes in the morning for your sakes, Lord. For mine, so I thought I'll just do what Solomon did. I'll split the baby down the middle. He didn't actually split the baby, but he threatened to. So I actually went through with it, and we split it into two parts. We started this morning by asking ourselves about our eyes, first of all. How are your eyes? Are you able to see clearly what you're supposed to see? Are you able to focus on the things that are important? How are your ears? Can you listen, and can you comprehend, or do you need to get them unclogged with the Word of God? And we talked about our diet. Is it a healthy one? Is it a balanced diet? Now, I am not the good physician. The good physician, of course, is Christ. Just consider me his messenger. And I'm going to relay some things that he might say to us. If we went into his doctor's office for a physical, what would he say? What questions would he ask us? Three more questions I want us to look at this morning, and then the night will be yours. First of all, what if he said to us, having given us a once-over, if he said, are you getting enough exercise? If you want to solve all kinds of health problems, not all health problems, but many kinds of health problems, one of the simplest things you can do is just to walk. It is just to get the blood pumping, to get some fresh air, to exercise your muscles. I've heard it is a great tool to exercise in the most simplest of ways, just to walk, just to go out around your lot, around your block, what have you. Just a nice brisk walk, whether it be in the morning or in the evening. And really, that alone is not enough. That's not all, but it's a lot that you can do to keep yourself fit and healthy. Spiritually, let me ask us, are we walking enough? Open your Bibles. Look at a text that's kind of obscure. It's Luke 13, verses 31 through 35. You're not going to find much that's obscure in the New Testament. Certainly, we study a lot. But this is not a text that we read very regularly or study from very regularly. It's Luke 13, 31 through 35. And as we read it, keep in mind, we're considering ourselves, are we walking spiritually like we're supposed to be? So let's look at the example of Christ and a walk that he engaged in toward the end of his life. Luke 13, starting at verse 31. The same day there came certain of the Pharisees, saying unto him, that's to Jesus, get thee out and depart hence, for Herod will kill thee. And he said unto them, go ye and tell that fox, behold, I cast out devils and do cures today and tomorrow, and the third day I shall be perfected. Nevertheless, I must walk today and tomorrow and the day following, for it cannot be that a prophet perish out of Jerusalem. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, which kills the prophets and stones them that are sent unto thee. How often would I have gathered thy children together as a hen does gather her brood under her wings, and you would not. That is to say, you would not go under his wings. 35. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate, and verily I say to you, you shall not see me until the time come when you shall say, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. The latter part of that text probably we're more familiar with, that sad lament by the Lord when he speaks of his people in Jerusalem, how I would have gathered you like a mother hen does to her chicks, but you would not let me. You didn't give me the opportunity. You rejected me. But it's the text just before that that we don't often consider very often. Jesus is walking toward Jerusalem. He is headed there, and we know what happens when he gets there. He will find the cross, and he will eventually lay down his life. But as he's headed there, the Pharisees meet him partway, and they say, you know if you go into the city, that Herod is going to kill you. Jesus says, you go tell that fox, you go tell that snake, you go tell that person, that guy, you go tell Herod that I am the miracle worker, that I am the one sent by God, and I am going to Jerusalem. I am going to walk day and night until I get there. Why, Jesus? Why are you so adamant on getting to Jerusalem? Why the hurry? Because I have to go to Jerusalem, he would say. Why? Because no prophet of God has ever been killed outside of Jerusalem. And Jesus knows what the end of his line is. I am going to die, and I'm not going to die outside of the holy city. I've got to go to the city where all the other prophets have gone, where they all went before, and all the people people before killed them. They're going to kill me too. Here is my master on his walk. This is not a walk for exercise. This is not a walk just to, you know, get his blood pumping. This is a mission of a walk. And he is walking day and night to go to the place that he knows will end with his death. That's a dedicated walk. How is your, how is my spiritual walk? Can we say we are as dedicated on our walk with God as our master was? There's so many verses to touch on. I just want to hit a few of them kind of in scattershot. Romans 8:4, Paul says that we are to walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. We walk in spiritual things, not in fleshly things, not in lustful things. Paul says in Romans 13:13 that we are to walk honestly in the sight of God and men. We talked about that a little bit this morning. Putting your eyes on the Father, putting your eyes on the needs of the world. We are to walk by faith. And my Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:7, we walk by faith, not by sight. Better translation, we walk by faith so that we don't have to walk by sight. It's not I walk by faith because I don't know whether it's true or not. I walk by faith because I don't need to see it. I don't need to see heaven to know that it's there. I walk by faith. So I don't have to walk by sight. He says in Ephesians 5:2, Paul does, that we walk in love as Christ loved us. He walked to Jerusalem because he loved you. How much will you walk for him and your love for him? Paul says Ephesians 5:8, we are to walk in his life. That is to say, we stay bathed in his life. John would say something similar in 1 John 1. And also Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 2:12 that we are to walk worthy of God, which is kind of a, not a scary thing, kind of an intimidating thought. That I am to walk in such a way that I am worthy of my Father in heaven. Can I say that? Can I say that the actions that I take and the things that I do in life is worthy of God? That's supposed to be my aim, my goal. So, are you getting enough exercise? Are you spiritually walking daily with your Lord? If you're not, according to my Bible, you're not going to be worthy of your Lord. According to my Bible, you're not going to be bathed in his light, so thus you'll be in darkness, removed from him. You're not going to be filled with his love, and you're not going to be walking honestly or living honestly in his sight. Maybe all of us could stand to walk a little more. Second question in this spiritual physical. Actually, it's not a question, it's a request. Say, ah. We ended this morning, if you remember, talking about our diet and the things, whether they're healthy or unhealthy, that we put in our bodies. Well, to go along with what you put in your body, naturally, is what comes out of your body. So how's your breath? It's kind of an uncomfortable question, isn't it? Just me saying it right now, we're probably all a little self-conscious wondering, how is my breath? You're thinking to yourself. Well, the majority of the problems that we have with regards to our breath revolve around our eating. Even if we don't eat, it's going to affect our breath. Our stomach acids are going to churn, and the fact there's no food there to break up in that acid is going to cause some raunchy breath. Even if you eat, what you eat will affect your breath. I love onions on my cheeseburger. My wife does not love onions on my cheeseburgers. Basically, what you put in affects what comes out. Listen to something my master said. Go to Mark chapter 7. Verses 20 through 23. Mark 7, 20 through 23. How is your spiritual breath? If you were to breathe what is inside you out and it smelled, what would the Lord think of the smell? Would it be pleasing or not so pleasing? Listen to what he says about your inner person. Mark 7, 20 through 23. Jesus said, that which comes out of the man, that defiles the man. For from within, out of the heart of men proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetous, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness, and all these things of evil come from within and defile the man. Jesus' point is, you don't just stumble into these sins. You don't just suddenly catch your arm punching someone. You had the thought you were going to do it. You had the intent, and you told yourself to make the action. You don't just catch yourself committing some sin. You have the inside man that desires to do so, and then it controls the outside man to do so. So what is rotten on the inside leads to something rotten on the outside. He lists eight things there in verse 22. He lists some more before, but just look at those eight that are right in the middle of the text. He says, thefts come from the inside out. Thefts, taking what's not yours. Covetousness, wanting what's not yours. Wickedness, to do unholy things just in general. Deceit, to mislead someone or to lie. To mislead or to lie, both are deceitfulness. Lasciviousness, to desire or to cause someone to desire to sinful things. An evil eye, to look at someone with disdain or with hateful thoughts. Blasphemy, to speak evil, not just of God, but of anyone. Pride, he says, to love self. There's eight things there in verse 22. Look at the variety of them. eight of them. You can group them into four pairs and see the variety. There are some sins that are inward sins, covetousness, pride. You can't tell that a person has them. They're inside. Outward sins, lasciviousness, blasphemy. Those are spotted. You can see them on the outside. There are obvious sins, thefts. You can't not tell us the person who stole it if he's holding the thing he's stolen. And wickedness. He does outwardly wicked things. But then there are hidden sins, inside sins, like evil eye and deceitfulness. You can get away with lying sometimes, at least not with God, but with your fellow man. So there are sins that are obvious, there are sins that are hidden, sins that are outside, sins that are inside. Look at the variety. But God says they all come from the same place, from your inside man. And so when you breathe out those actions, he smells it, and it smells rotten to him. What comes out of your mouth reflects your heart, is what my master said. So let's ask the third question. Very natural progression there. If what comes out of me is a reflection of my heart, let's ask ourselves this last question in our physical, the most important one of all. How's your heart? That's the one we're always worried about when we go to the doctor, we have to get our checkup. I'm wondering, what's it going to say about my heart? How's my cholesterol level? What's my blood pressure like? Is my heart in a regular pattern, a regular rhythm? How's my heart, doctor? He'll ask me, even though he has the answer, just to make me sweat a little bit. How's your heart? Well, Lord, he might ask us, how's my spiritual heart? If your heart is not used properly, if you don't exercise enough, your heart can grow weak, it can grow unfunctioning, and then eventually it can kill you. If your spiritual heart is not used properly enough, it can grow weak, unfunctioning, and spiritually can kill you. So how's your heart? Is it full of love? Is it full of kind affection? Is it full of loving kindness? A weak physical heart struggles because it struggles to pump blood enough that you need to survive. A weak spiritual heart struggles because it can't pump enough Christian zeal to survive. That was the problem with the church at Laodicea in Revelation chapter 3, verse 15. They weren't evil. There's some other ones that were pretty wicked. Laodicea, they weren't evil. They weren't wicked. They had just rejected Christ. They hadn't gone into paganism. The problem with Laodicea in Revelation 3 was they were just lukewarm. It wasn't that they didn't care or that they didn't like God anymore. It was just they didn't care. It wasn't that they were cold. It was just that they weren't also not hot. They were nothing. They were just bland. And so God says, Jesus says, if I could have eaten you, you would have been bland and lukewarm, and I would have vomited you out of my mouth. He needs zeal. My Christian heart has to pump that zeal. If I don't work it, it will not work for me. And thus I won't be able to work for the Lord, or I won't want to. And so my heart will die. I need to maintain a healthy spiritual heart. How do I do that? Three ways. Colossians 3:15, first of all, let peace rule in your heart. That's what Paul says in Colossians 3:15. Let the peace of God rule. Take over and control your hearts, to which you're also called in one body, and be ye thankful. If I have anxiety, physically speaking, anxiety is not a cause of a heart attack. It can be a trigger to a heart attack. All of the other things that I've done to myself that have put me on the edge of a heart attack are there because I've done those things. Anxiety is what puts me over the edge. Anxiety and nervousness, high blood pressure, all of that that comes from anxiousness, anxiety, that can be the straw that breaks the camel's back. Spiritually, if I'm anxious, my heart cannot work for God. I am focused on those things around me that are causing me worry, causing me stress, and causing me distraction. I need to let go of my anxiety and let peace, the peace that God provides, rule my heart. And then those problems that compound, like the symptoms of a heart attack, without anxiety, those problems will not break my heart. They'll melt away. Something else you can do. Second thing, purify your hearts. That's James 4, verse 8. He says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded people. Too much cholesterol will clog your arteries. Too much love of the world will clog your spiritual arteries, that pathway that leads between you and your Father. You clog them up with love of money, love of self, love of world, in whatever form it takes. James says, the closer you draw near to God, the more purified your heart becomes. Because where God is, he's 100% free from sin. Where I am, I'm totally surrounded by it. It's all around me in the world. So I need to spiritually draw near to God. And the closer I draw near to God spiritually, the farther away I get from sin. Because he can't have anything to do with it. He can't have it in his presence at all. So I know the closer I am to him, the farther away I am from it. The problem is I try to reach one hand to God and one hand to the world and try to straddle the fence. No, I've got to let go, cleanse, and purify all those imperfections that are clogging up the arteries of my spiritual heart. Third thing I can do to maintain a healthy spiritual heart is I can strengthen it. James 5:8, just one chapter over. James 5:8, he says, be patient, establish. Not establish, but just establish. In the King James, your heart for the coming of the Lord draws near. The harder your heart has to work, the weaker it becomes over time. And eventually it only does so much before it just quits on you. It's funny how that happens. Think about it. The less you do physically, the less you physically exert yourself, the harder your heart has to work for you. Think of it like that. So the harder you work physically, the more you exert yourself, the less your heart has to do to make up for it. Well, the same is true spiritually. The less you do with your spiritual life, the more your spiritual heart will have to work to keep you going. That inside voice, that conscience that God has given you by His Word, that it says every morning you got to wake up because you got to get dressed, you got to go to worship. That says every time you go to work, you got to make sure you put on a good Christian face because your coworkers aren't brethren in Christ and you might be able to influence them. That same heart that says when you come home from work, hey, you got to get dressed, you got to eat a quick meal because you got Bible study tonight. You have all those things inside you. That heart has to work extra hard if you're not getting up and doing the actions and making it work. So if you're not working your spiritual life, your spiritual heart is going to go into overdrive, and eventually it's not going to do it forever. It's gone. And then you're just spiritually dead. And because this is a spiritual problem, not a physical one, you don't even know when you've had the spiritual cardiac arrest. You don't even know, you don't even realize when you spiritually stop beating and stop having zeal for the Lord. And that's when you're really in danger. That's when your heart gets calloused. So James says, establish your heart. The word means make solid. Build like with a foundation. Make it concrete. Make it strong. Your heart. How does he do that? He tells you in the verse by being patient and focused on the second coming of Christ. The word patient doesn't mean stand still and don't do anything. Just stand still like this. No, I'm being patient. Look at me being patient. That's not patience to God. Patience, as the Bible uses it, means to do what has to be done without anxiety and without distraction. You're not nervous, wondering when, wondering if, wondering how. You're patient. But you'll just do what you need to do. Take care of your job. Let God take care of His. We already talked about anxiety and distractions. You put those together, and that's how you find patience, by removing those obstacles that can ruin your spiritual heart. So that's the physical. We've looked at our eyes, looked at our ears, we've looked at our diet and our exercise. We've touched on the most important ingredient, our heart. Speaking on behalf of the doctor, I got good news for you, patient, and I have bad news. Let's get the bad news out of the way first. Bad news is, you're terminal. You don't have a chance. You're going to die. There is a disease out there that has affected everybody. Everybody has caught it, and you've caught it as well. You're going to die from the disease of sin. And even if you are cured of this disease, and there is a cure, you're still going to die. Unless the doctor comes back within our lifetimes, which let's assume for the moment that he doesn't, you're going to die because of this disease. It's already done its work on you. The good news is, the doctor that I work for, the doctor that I know, is a miracle worker. And he can not only cure you, but even if this disease kills you, he can raise you up from the dead and let you live with him where you'll never be infected again. How's that sound? All you have to do is trust the doctor and take his prescription. Trust the doctor and follow his prescription. Mark 16:16. Repent and be baptized. Acts 2:38. And he will take away your sins, curing you of the disease, putting you in a spiritual body where you, if you live faithful to him, can be free from that disease henceforth. And just live faithful until he comes back. And when he comes back, even if you're dead, he'll raise you up to live with him in heaven forever and ever. Are you a faithful Christian? If not, now is your opportunity to become one. If we can help you, let us know how right now as we stand and sing.